Well, hello everybody. Welcome back to the next segment of Big Bang Theories. Big Bang Theory L's BTS vlog. It is 1 hour and 32 minutes, or 33 minutes, into the day of Friday, July 1st, 2016. That's right, it's Canada Day. Well, officially anyways, it's the 1st, so we're past midnight, so we are now starting on a, we're beginning our third month back to regular vlogging. So, I'm pretty happy with the way things are going. Excuse me. Yawning once again. I filmed two videos in the studio. I've got to now bring them over to the editing bay. I'm planning to film more again tomorrow. So, yeah, I'm not taking the day off. And we continue our work here at the Starship Enterprise. So, that's the way it is. Starship Enterprise, living in a space colony. You live where you work, and you make the best of it. You make this, that's how you make your living. And that's, well, I guess you live in your, or you die in that respect anyways, you know. Can you, you know, make a good life for yourself? And I believe I can. I believe that there are a lot of things that are missing from a lot of the so-called high-tech adventure there, where everybody's sort of, everything has to be high-tech and modern. The problem with modern lifestyle, and most modern lifestyle, is that there's nothing actually there. There's no family, there's no soul, there's no warmth. It's cold and steel. So glass and steel, cement, concrete, that's your modern architecture, that's your modern view of things. There's no soul, there's no life, there's no joy, nothing. And when you're living life, you experience a lot of things. You experience, well, pain. There's discomfort, there's things you have to deal with that are not necessarily pleasant in terms of how you deal with things in terms of interpersonal relationship, how you deal with different events that occur in your life that may be emotional. These are all different things that have to be dealt with. This is what it means to be alive. And of course, you have situations that bring you joy, that make you laugh, that make you smile, that bring you... I hate to use the term pleasure, but in a esoteric fashion, in a emotional fashion, so it's an emotional pleasure rather than a physical or sensual pleasure, which in many cases often ends up, and this is where you do this by observation, you go out and see those who seek physical pleasures. And you watch their lives as they go along. They're the ones who are doing the cutting. They cut themselves. They drink themselves into a stupor. And eventually, at some point in time, if they don't resolve these issues soon, they become very lonely. They become very depressed. And they often commit suicide. So now, ask yourself, okay, is this person very happy? Are they living a pleasurable life? And the answer is no. Their pleasure is temporary. And then once that temporary pleasure is gone, they cannot replace it again. And this is the problem. They keep trying to chase the initial pleasure, the initial high they have, but are never able to seek what they truly are looking for. And in other words, you're looking for something, but you're looking in all the wrong places. And rather than getting what you hope to get, you're getting something that only brings you, after the initial physical pleasure, it brings you emotional pain. It brings you sadness. And you can see this in Europe, because Europe is really, you know, a lot of what I'll be going into in terms of the history of socialism. And this is very well intertwined with what's going on in Europe, what's going on now in Europe with this whole immigration crisis. Is you have a situation in which the soul of Europe is dead. There is no more soul. They say, oh, we're intellectuals. No, they're not intellectuals anymore. They're animals. The path that they've taken down that turns through this so-called conceptual and abstract intellectualism that conforms to nothing, that has no shape or any resemblance to reality whatsoever. It's pure fantasy. And then they wonder why it fails, because every time they keep trying it again and again and again, and it always fails. And they are so glum about this, because why? Because they can't seem to understand why it failed. If something you're thinking about and trying to bring forward has no degree of reality to it, and you don't see how to bring reality into the situation, in other words, you simply assume that you're intelligent and your ideas are amazing. And this is the sort of the view a lot of the left takes. This is why they call themselves progressives. They don't call themselves, regressives, who, looking at the end result and seeing how much damage they cause society. They don't call themselves regressives. They call themselves progressive. Their view is burn society down, burn the establishment down, and then in the ashes, the new understanding, the new life will follow, and we will have happiness. And it's never worked. It's never, not once has it ever worked. And the thing is that they always end up with the question, why? Why doesn't it work? Why can't we have happiness? And it's because a lot of the things that they're doing in terms of bringing happiness is temporary. It's a temporary physical pleasure. And they're expecting an emotional happiness that can't be brought through simple physical or material things. And if you simply dismiss the emotional, you dismiss the soul and say it no longer exists, that we are simply animals, then there's no more point to anything anymore. And then there is no more happiness at the end. No happiness gained, no happiness emerges. And this they fail to understand. Anyways, I think I'm going to leave it here for now. give us a good understanding here. And everybody's gone. It's very quiet around here because it's Canada Day. So everybody's off for the weekend. And so I don't expect anyone to be around. For very much longer, well, for at all. So, I think I'm gonna spend an hour out here, and then go back in, do some more filming, and see what happens. I'm making some more tea. I'm trying to finish up some of the laundry that I've got left to do. So I'm almost done, but it always seems to be that there's one more batch to do. And so, I'm on my second to last batch. I have. This is the last backup batch, but then I also have new stuff that's just sort of piled up for the week. I have the week's laundry still to do, so. Still work, is it the mundane? Trying to catch up and work on the mundane. Then I also have to clean the kitchen. There's kitchen cleaning that has to be done. And I have to finish cleaning the electronics bench. That area there still needs to be cleaned up and sort of dealt with, so. That's what's going to be for the remainder of the night, in addition to some note-taking and writing up some of the notes, the production notes for Living the Kawaii Life and Beauty and the Geek. So, see you in a bit. Well, whenever I come back. I don't know if it's going to be a bit, but... All right, take it easy. Well, it is 16 hours and 30 minutes into the day of Saturday, July 2nd, 2016. Yeah, 7 minutes before. Let's make sure I got this right. 16 hours and 30 minutes into the day. Yeah, I'm going food shopping. We'll see if the stores are open. Basically, we've had Canada Day was July 1st. And from people I talk to, they say the stores are open on the 2nd. So that's today, the Saturday. And that's where I'm going. I'm going food shopping. Our peripatetics. That's why I didn't vlog last night. I didn't go outside and sit on the couch. I waited till today. Looks like some rain clouds are coming in. We'll see if that kind of interrupts our tea house tonight, being out on the patio. And right now there's not much going through my mind. It just, just doing getting the work done. Again, I said there's a lot of mundane stuff that has to be done. And as you go through your mind, just sort of trying to remember what to get done and in what order. It consumes time. So my body wasn't fully up to it this week, today, to go food shopping, but sometimes things have to be done when they need to be done, so that's the situation here, and I didn't vlog earlier, on the earlier section of the walk, simply because, one, there was too much wind, and the second part, I couldn't see my cell phone to get the date and time. So I was able to do that here. There was enough shadow, enough shade. It seems here like they cleared a lot of stuff out. So this looks like they've been clearing a lot of things out. The whole bush that was here before is gone. Which is kind of a shame because, I know it looks neater in terms of from a gardening sense. You want to have nice edges. But from a standpoint of wildlife and wilderness, it's, the bush is better. So, but anyways, they left most of it here. And so the flowers are now starting to develop into their form they're going to be in by the time it gets to fall. So, considering the cold nights and actually the cooler days, there's a bit of a breeze out, so even though it's in the afternoon, about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, about 4:30, it's not as hot, it's like 73 degrees, and there's a nice breeze. It looks like from the clouds that, you can see the clouds here, it looks like there's a nice, a rainstorm's going to come in tonight, but I'm not really too sure if that's the case or whether it'll simply pass over us and that'll be it. But anyways, I've got a cross here. This is another usually dangerous area, but we'll see. We'll see what happens. Now this will know how to sort of figure out here if the doors are open or not, because it looks like some of the stores are open, so I'm going to go all the way to the mall. This is the first mall. This is the second mall I go to, so this is the halfway point, the mall there. As I said, I'm in an Asian neighborhood, so yay for me. Well, it's Boxing Day every day for me, so great discounts. Nothing's ever too expensive, so happy for that. Anyways, I'll see you next time, man. On my way back. Let's see if I kind of figure out anything to say or Alrighty, take it easy. Hello everybody, welcome back. We're on our way back. It is just about 17 hours and 20 minutes into the day of Saturday, July 2nd, 2016. Food prices have gone up. You know, as expected with the carbon taxes on there, is, you know, everything's gone up. But this is the thing about the liberals, about the Democrats, the people on the left. They talk about being nice and philanthropic to the people who are poor, talk about poor people, helping them out. What's the result? Well, when the carbon taxes came in, all the food prices went up. That meant more people are now going to food banks than ever before. Is this helping the poor person, creating more poverty, creating more people dependent on the government, creating a situation almost like Venezuela? Is this socialism? But the reality is, if you look at history, that's exactly what socialism is. Socialism has never produced anything for the poor except for misery and death. This is the reality of socialism. The rest that people talk about, that you hear about people on the so-called progressive side of things, it's all fantasy. None of it's reality. And it's completely ignorant of history. And yet these people consider themselves to be high-level intellectuals. They are intellectuals. They think. They're free thinkers. But when you point out history, and you point out the history of socialism, and all the damage it's done to society, they completely ignore it. Well, it's their right to ignore it. Yeah, you can ignore anything you want, and you can say anything you want. Just don't contradict the liberals. Don't show them the folly of their ways. This is not stating that the other social systems that came before it, basically Roman Catholicism and the monarchies that it produced, including the Protestant monarchies or even some of the, let's call them, pagan monarchies. This is pre-Christian in some sense. None of them were merciful. None of them considered philanthropy. Philanthropy, if you study it properly, look into the archives, go into the history of philanthropy, began with the Christians. It actually began with Christ. And now let's make a distinction here. The Christian evangelicals, the Christians we see, even the Roman Catholics, they're not related to the early Christians. Their philosophies, their thinking, is fundamentally opposite. It's not the same as the early Christians. They're a much more warlike, paganistic type of Christian than they are to the early Christians. So in other words, their Christianity is, you can say, is very pagan-like. Anyways, we're gonna cross here. I'll be back in a few minutes. All right, so we're back with our walks, our peripatetics. And peripatetics is meditation, is a type of walking, type of thinking. And this is how, in the East, philosophy was done. And I'm talking about the sort of the Christian pagans. And the Christian pagans are basically the evangelical right. And even some of the Roman Catholic from there on out. What happened is the theology changed around 1000 AD with the papacy that produced the Roman Catholic Church. And it essentially rejected the entire life of Christ and stated that God was an angry God, he was a war God, And therefore, rather than dying like the early Christian martyrs for the faith peacefully, they created a holy war. And this is how Western Christianity created Europe, the European Empire. And they spent close to 700 years defending this particular point of view. And then wars, mass murder, annihilation. I mean, go back and study the Battle of Hastings, 1064, Battle of Hastings. See what the papacy did to the English there, to the people of the British Isles. And you'll see it's not nice. You'll see how Roman Catholicism formed. And you'll understand a lot of the arguments that the atheists have against Christianity is fundamentally aimed at the Roman Catholic Church and the horrors that emerged from the Roman Catholic Church from about 1000 AD all the way to about 1700 AD. Now, that doesn't mean after 1700 AD that the horror stopped. No, it simply took a new form. 1700 AD, the Protestants were well up and developing. So you had their armies competing with the papal armies. Again, the Protestants rejected the power of the papacy and chose the power of the institutional church. Still God Almighty, no longer God the Father. But now, they've simply removed the Pope. And without the Pope in power, well, of course the kings and queens become the head of the church. This is what you have with the Anglican Church and a number of the other Protestant offshoots. The government takes control. The state takes control. So, what happens next? Well, 1800s, well, tired of the monarchies, various groups got up there and started trying to eliminate the monarchies. And that's what you have from basically 800 to just about World War II, the end of World War II, 1945, is you have the elimination of monarchies. And this was done with the birth of a form of socialism called humanism. This is when socialism emerges. And you can actually go back and take a look at this, the early starts of socialism, about 1800 AD, by going back and taking a look and reading about Dostoevsky. Read Dostoevsky, that gives you a very good early primer into socialism. How you doing? Good, how you doing? And what you see there is you start seeing the ideas that socialism has are well formed by 1800. And the funny thing is, the number of people who use Dostoevsky for the left don't understand that Dostoevsky, as he wrote his last pieces, particularly the Brothers Karamazov, had left socialism. He had gone back to the Eastern Christianity that was in Russia. The Russian Christianity that's in there is not a Western Christianity. It's a Eastern Christianity. And Dostoevsky had left socialism and gone back to Christianity. But the thing is, that's not discussed. That's never discussed when socialists bring up Dostoevsky. They completely ignore that part. They simply take the parts that are convenient for them, the quotations. That's why you'll never see me quote anything. I want you to read the entire thing. I'm not telling you to say, oh, go take a look at this part here. It confirms what I'm saying. I'm saying do the studying, do the research. That's how you begin to understand what I'm talking about, if you don't already know what I'm talking about. There is no substitute for studying, so therefore, there's no need for quotes. Because I'm not going to quote something, say, oh, here's my proof. I'm not proving anything to you. This is a discussion. If you want to go find something out further, then you go do the research. Again, I'm saying that again. There's no substitution for research. When I talk about Dostoevsky, do a blank lookup on who Dostoevsky is. His whole name is Fyodor Dostoevsky. And see what you find. Do a study. And a good study will take 2 or 3 months. It is not going to be a fast and easy thing. It's not going to be a quick thing. Particularly if you've got no experience in this. If this is your first time coming into this, and what you're used to before is someone give you a quote, and you just briefly go check the article to see, okay, this is what this is. No. This is, you have to study. This is, you have to do the work. There is no substitution. There is no shortcut. Sorry about that. But this is the way it is. If you really want to have an understanding, you have to do the work. It's that simple. My nose is runny. Yeah, that's better. Yeah. We're back on our normal part. We're back on the part where I started. We're sort of going back home now. I've got to cross this place a little quickly. Cars come up from under there, so you have to be careful when you cross to make sure you're not crossing in front of anybody. Because you never know. So I'm over far enough now. I'm out far enough that I'm safe. So let's continue our discussion. As I said before, socialism really started, had its beginning in 1800. It was a further development. You had Roman Catholicism. Roman Catholicism, you had development of the Protestant Church. Off of the Protestant Church, now you have socialism, but the Protestant Church split further and produced the evangelicals. And the evangelicals are what we know today as the Christian Right. They formed all the groups in the United States, including the Mormons. The Mormons came out of the evangelical denominations. Same thing with the Pentecostalists, the Quakers, the Shakers, and so on, the Puritans. They all came out of this one particular Protestant sort of grouping, if you will. Just like atheism came out as one of these sort of offspring. And atheism, the socialism, was now looking at a world without kings. And that's what the 1800s and 1900s were all about, primarily. Getting rid of the monarchies. And this is where it brings into this whole thing about Illuminati and Masonic rituals. Because the people who were behind this were the Masons and the Illuminati. They're out there to eliminate the monarchy. But who were these so-called Masons? And you can find them on the dollar bill. You can find them in Washington, D.C. One of them were George Washington, Abraham Lincoln. Benjamin Franklin, Thomas Jefferson. They were all Masonics. And you can see the Masonic symbols in Washington, D.C. On display there. So it's not wasn't that it's hidden. It is there. But it's that group who walked away from monarchy. But they themselves weren't poor. They weren't even middle class. A large chunk of them were actually aristocracy. They were aristocracy who wanted the power and control for themselves. And this is what socialism is about. Socialism is not about giving the power to the people. It's about taking the power from the people, making them believe as they give you their freedoms, right? You say, oh, I'm going to give you your freedom, but you have to give me something in return. I'm going to protect you, right? This is the rhetoric, right? We're philanthropists. We care about you. The end result, as you give them your freedoms, as they give under the guise of security, your freedom's gone, and now you're enslaved by this group. So in other words, it's the king of the hill, it's the whole thing to fight for power again. Before you had the fight for power amongst kings and queens, now you have amongst the aristocracy. And this is the aristocracy knocking off the kings and queens and creating this newfangled democracy that is really totalitarianism. And this is the same thing. Pol Pot considered himself to be a democracy. Hitler considered himself to be a democracy. Same thing with Stalin. They never considered themselves to be dictators. They were doing democracy. But this is the new European democracy. It wasn't individualism. It was socialism. And ironically enough, if you go back to the early Christian church, where this all sort of in some ways began, the early Christian church does not support socialism. It supports individualism. No kings. Because the kings, under early Christianity, were ordered to adopt their servants the way God adopted the people on earth as his own children. They're ordered to follow that example. And this is why the early Christian church was rejected. Because the kings wouldn't give up their power. See you in a bit. Actually, see you next episode. Because I think it's going to be it for this episode.
Professor. And professor of what? Professor of physics.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light?
Free speech rules here at Democratic Earth.